Korean coach versus Chinese coach.
The battle. No, we're not going to go into that.
It rages.
But, yeah, QG already banning away the Ezreal. Makes a whole lot of sense, of course. Getting a few nightmares from Dade as Kalista's going to be banned away as well. Azir hitting the bench and Pawn getting finally some respect for that champion as Ryze is going to be taken away as well.
I forgot that we were actually playing League of Legends
today.
Yeah,
League of Legends. Welcome, Froskren.
Welcome back. No surprises to see Kalista and Ryze banned from purple side. Again, it's fairly standard. Curious what the last staple ban will be. Again, this is 5.13. Tom Kench is live and available. If only. It's going to be Echo.
Yeah, Echo, of course, another very standard ban here. And we have seen from the red side the Kalista Ryze Echo being just generally what's banned away. But Twist of Fate, interestingly enough, is going to be taken away from Pawn.
No surprises there. Again, it's kind of been on the up and up. And again, when Twisted Fate is banned, though, or picked up by EDG, it really does open Clear Love to look towards that Evelynn pickup, which, again, 5.13, Rune Glaive Evelynn is definitely a thing, and Clear Love is definitely running it.
He's well and truly on that hype train. And the Gragas is going to get locked in here. Clear Love very, very able to pick up the Evelynn here because no Rek'Sai to come out of this team. Of course, Gragas in the jungle isn't going to have any Tremor Sense to spot the stealthed up lady, but Koro wastes no time locking in that Shen in response, and it is going to be Deft back on the Corki.
I always, anytime I see a Corki Hubbard, I get the quote in my head. It's like, I'm up to snuff. Got me. I don't know what. Obviously, there's no reason for EDG to pick up their jungler in second rotation because Gragas was picked up,
exactly.
So they don't need to buy it. So they grab their two priority picks, and you saw the immediate insta-lock on that Shen. Shen is super high priority in the LPL, and Koro has actually looked really good on it.
He most certainly has. Of course, we just saw an MVP for the Shen in our previous game, if you can remember that far, ladies and gentlemen. Zatai did manage to grab that one here as Doinbee is hovering over a Sivir here for TNT, and Swift, Maokai, a bit of a blast from the past there as we're going to put a tree back in the top lane.
I really like this pickup. Again, there's no reason to grab the Sivir because you already see that it's a Corki, so you don't need to pick up the AD carry.
Yep.
Opens you to pick up the Braum, deny it from Mako, and more importantly, as a counter to Corki.
And why would a Braum be a counter to Corki?
Poke. So Corki obviously is going
stop
to...
stop the rockets.
Yeah. I do this all the time where I don't connect A to B, and then my play-by-play caster's like, remember, show your work.
Yeah, there's also a whole lot of people watching that need to know what the heck's going on.
Braum puts up a massive wall and absorbs a lot of poke damage, so it's really good against champions like Corki.
In fact, if there's stuff coming at your team, make sure you put a chair in front of it.
Yep.
That is the rule.
Well, put the chair up.
Pawn at the moment, hovering a Fiddlesticks, would make a whole lot of sense if he was to lock that in because he's Pawn and he doesn't have a champion pool. He's got a champion everything.
A champion ocean. He's played 22 unique champions, the most of any LPL mid laner, but it is going to be the Clear Love special.
Yeah, the Clear Love special. Don't get too excited here. Happy birthday, Clear Love. Able to play the Evelynn here as Deft, hovering over a Tahm Kench. Oh my goodness. Not going to happen.
They tease me all night. I really want the Tahm Kench, but
so
it is instead going to be the Jonathan.
Janna going to be locked in here, so Mako going to have a bit of disengage in his kit, help out Deft there on the bottom side of the map, assuming that's where they're going to go. And QG, now time for them to round out their lineup, and they need some damage. Frostgrave.
I feel like Victor, super far down on the pick rotation. We already saw,
Surprise, surprise. Frostgrave is correct. Victor considered by TCT at the moment. TNT going back to sort of the on-the-hunt champion. You just call Sivir by her ultimate, basically.
That one girl that makes them all run real quick.
Yeah.
Okay, this...
The Donkey Whistle is what I like to call it.
That's an interesting name.
Yeah, it's Donkey Whistle. It especially works in solo queue because you know that as soon as Sivir yells, everyone's going in. It's the best way to communicate without actually doing anything.
This comp, though, is classic Xiaogu. So we talked about kind of in our pre-game show.
Yeah.
That, the compositions would really tell us how seriously either team is going to be taking this match. Now, we don't see a lot of experimentation here. This is a very comfort pick across the board. But Xiaogu's comp, the Sivir Braum, not necessarily the Braum, it's typically an Annie or a Janna for TCT, but just the rest of these champions, they've run this
so many times.
So many times. This exact thing. This is what Xiaogu does. This is what they love to do. On the other side, remember what I said about Pawn and his casting?
Yeah.
So good. There we go.
And he's going to lock it in against Doinbee as well, who is another player who really loves getting that Kassadin up in other players' grills. And he's been making things happen on that champion as well. So we'll see whether Pawn is going to be able to do the same thing that Doinbee was able to do to Dade yesterday in game one.
Completely agree. Now, we saw kind of the Kassadin as the, I'm going to call it a soft counter to Victor, come out when Godby first brought it out. I actually believe he brought it out against Doinbi.
Could have.
And so since then, it's kind of just been a thing for LPL mid laners. You see a Victor, you pick a Kassadin.
Yeah.
It's a little bit difficult for Victor to push Kassadin out of lane early. Naturally, Victor will get his upgraded Hex Core and gets great wave clear with the evolution point, as well as some upgraded levels on the AP item there. But Kassadin, it's not the worst lane for him. You have to think, what's Victor really susceptible to? It's when people get on top of him, because his only real answer then is to drop his gravitational field and hope the CC locks him up. But Kassadin's Rift Walk cooldown is so low that he can quickly just reposition himself. So it makes the lane pretty tricky for Victor once Kassadin has that post level 6.
And I like to think of it not as necessarily a counter as we go through the rosters, is more of it's just Kassadin can easily get through this lane. The spell shield's so incredibly important for it, and able to make things work, and Klilov going to be taking his Evelynn into Swift Gragas. Of course, Gragas definitely just a staple jungler here. Swift has been fantastic on the champion as well, but Doinbi on his Victor definitely has been fantastic for Xiaogu, but against the Kassadin out of pawn, he's going to be very, very frightening. And TNT taking the Sivir, lots of AoE, AD damage into a very mixed damage Corki. TCT with the engage takes on Mako with disengage.
Likewise, though, I love the fact that Braum also does bring pretty strong disengage
on
how you use his
the kite back mechanics.
The fissure.
Yeah, of course. And of course, over a team fight as well, the fact that you can have that glacial fissure just knocks everyone up, keeps them in the same position, allows everyone to nail everything that they can. But, ladies and gentlemen, we did take a little bit of time there, so we're going to waste none more and head straight into game. After that awkward segue, we are onto the Rift for Xiaogu versus EDG. Xiaogu starting off on the blue side, as EDG are going to be wearing some red pants this game. And by the looks of things, some defensive starts, no invades just yet.
Both teams lining up to start a possible 2v2 in the bot side. So curious if we're going to find a lane swap, especially because Sivir is on the field. Now, Sivir and Braum, I would actually recommend that you lane swap it, just because A, Sivir's going to have much more pressure onto any sort of tower. But more importantly, that would unlock Braum, TCT on this champion, to roam around early and make use of his very powerful level 1 due to that Q.
Yeah, the fact that you can get the Q, get the passive happening as well. 4 stacks, not too difficult when you've got a few people running around as well. So we'll see whether TCT can make some moves here, but by the looks of things, it is going to be a standard 2v2.
Yep, although I feel like any time you're 2v2ing against Sivir, you're actually just 2v2 against creeps.
Yeah, it's more of a 2v0.
So, as you spotted out, how this lane's going to go down, because it looks like we will have the Corki versus Sivir, is for the first initial 1 through 5, Sivir should have the advantage here. She's going to have more wave control with her Ricochet, the W.
Yep.
Getting control there. Now, naturally, Corki can walk into the lane and drop his Phosphorus Bomb on the back caster creeps and try to wrestle control back, but I'm still going to give it to Sivir, especially with the auto reset. Now, where the lane starts to shift back in power to Corki is once he has his level 6, because obviously being able to spam out those rockets, it's very easy to trigger Sivir's spell shield and punish her with a lot of damage.
Yeah, just the burst damage out of a Corki is also fantastic as well. Mako going to be augmenting that with the Eye of the Storm. But both of the junglers going to be starting off on the Krugs. Bit of a handy stun coming out from Braum as well.
Oh, she just sneezed, sorry.
Oh, I thought you were having a chuckle about
that. No.
Nope, not going to be the case. Kari going to be following Clearlove around to the red buff here as well. Not wanting to get to lane, as the team is saying that, yes, there is no Kari in this one, but making sure that Clearlove is as healthy as possible as he continues his jungle route. We'll see what that is going to net the team, as Kari making some very sacrificial plays early on.
It's not going to hurt him too bad, because obviously he was able to share a lot of that EXP. Already has the level 2 to V's level 1, burning his teleport, so there technically is a TP advantage on the side of Xiaogu. Doubt that we'll see that used within the next 5 minutes, excuse me, 4 minutes, because Koro teleported to the tower, but you never know.
Yeah, and by the looks of things as well, Koro did get enough experience by taking those Krugs and the red buff in order to get himself to level 2 as well. So that is going to be finally down about 4 CS, and so far EDG with a lot of control here on the bottom side of the map.
Really early ward coming out of Doinbi. So what he did is, again, Kassadin doesn't have a lot of wave control, wave clear, pushed him in and then walked over and placed his trinket on top of Clear Love's blue buff. And this is how you ward against an Evelynn. You ward her camps because she needs to come out of stealth to do the camps, and then you get the trigger off the vision.
sort of the only time when you can reliably see Evelynn with a Sight Ward as opposed to a Vision Ward. Of course, Vision Wards now being permanently visible makes it a little bit more difficult to rely on. Take down that Eve.
We talked about how Sivir should have control of this, but it's actually Deft and Mako who got control of the wave. So again, quirky, it's possible for him to do it. Typically has to burn his Phosphorus Bomb on the back caster creeps, and then probably just step forward and abuse with Mako's Eye of the Storm.
Yeah, it's just the fact that Deft's been able to get a whole lot of extra harassment off here as well. You can see Clearlove now picked up his blue buff, still at half health. Doesn't have any pots left, but is most definitely comfortable in the jungle at the moment. So Windspite, not going to find the mark here on the bottom side of the map, but you can see half health for both of the Xiaogu bottom laners. And that Phosphorus Bomb was fantastically placed by Deft, making sure the TCT not going to be engaging anytime soon.
And this is also a big issue with Braum. So his level 1 is incredibly strong because he's going to be throwing out the Q, and if he's able to connect it with the concussive blows, naturally you get the CC as well as the bonus magic damage. But he's not ranged. He's a melee support champion, so obviously Janna is going to be able to float up and hit him when he cannot hit her.
I like how you use the float there as well, as Karl and Bade is going to be punching each other a little bit. But look, honestly, the wet noodle fight of wet noodle fights. No one's going to be dying there, as Spellshield is going to block the Phosphorus Bomb in the bottom lane, and Clearlove paying some attention to the mid as Doinby is very low on mana. Khorne definitely running out as well.
But he's doing a great job making sure that he's positioned on the top side of the mid lane, naturally because his jungler's over there, as well as the security of the Scuttlecrab.
Yeah, making sure that they know where Clearlove might be roaming around. Some nice vision here means that Clearlove's going to be able to grab this Raptor. Swift Body Slams over, finds Clearlove, but a little bit too late. The hate spikes are going to come down as well. Clearlove procs that, and he's even going to be able to kill a ward.
And more importantly, Clearlove is able to be this aggressive over the ward because Doinby has no mana.
Oh, Swift actually down to about 200 health here as Clearlove's able to get a lot of damage off the flash to follow here from Clearlove as the flash comes out of Swift as well.
Oh,
smited for the kill as the Chilling Smite had already been purchased, and Swift's going to go down for first blood. Happy birthday, Clearlove.
And again, it goes back to the fact that Doinby was unable to assist Swift over there, and great communication from Pawn to say Victor can't follow. He has no mana.
Nothing that they could do about it, and already EDG picking up first blood onto their jungler on his own. Able to pick up first blood. Very cute. I like the fact that it's his birthday.
Carnivore Clearlove.
Yeah. Starting out, getting overly aggressive. Talk about him as a herbivore. Not this time.
Here comes V, though. Get in there, tree.
Try and do something here. Pawn back in an interesting location here as V had full vision of him. Gets a ward over the side. Pawn auto reset. Gets it down to one health, but still going to be fine. But Pawn back has been stopped, so it might lose some creeps to the turret here.
Cute little roam from V, though, to try and make something happen for his mid laner. Doesn't lose much for it. In fact, he's pretty much even with Koro and CS.
Yeah. A couple of Doran's rings here as well, as Pawn did hang around, making sure that he could pick up this minion wave. That's it, level 6 as well.
And this is the aspect when it starts to get a little bit scary for Victor in this lane, because again, it's not necessarily a counter, I'm glad that you clarified that, but it's more so that Kassadin has a lot of tools to really punish Victor, and the fact that he doesn't have a ton of mobility, that when you do jump on top of him, he's pretty much entirely reliant on the gravitational field going down, and Kassadin's low cooldown is able to put him back into safety before that CC can lock him up.
You can see in the top lane, V able to get some nice harassment off onto Koro. Now just going to heal himself back up with those powerful blades. TNT taking some harassment here on the bottom side of the map. Mako is going to knock up TCT. Gatling guns out as TCT takes a bunch of damage. EDG's bottom lane still very aggressive. And look at the Sheen purchase from Deft as well, making sure that he can have as much damage in this lane as possible, not going for the safety of the Phage.
And naturally, there is an itemization advantage to Deft, the fact that he has that Sheen, that he's going to be able to out-trade Sivir right now, especially if he connects with the Phosphorus Bomb. Even if he doesn't, then he'll get the immediate Sheen proc. But more importantly, TCT has to hit these Braum Qs. If he completely whiffs it, they've automatically already lost the trade.
Yeah, so a lot of pressure onto TCT at the moment. Koro just throwing out sticks. Throwing sticks at the tree. Rift Warp from Pawn here in the mid lane. Gravity Field not going to be able to find any stuns as Pawn's able to close the distance. Another Rift Warp.
Yep, what we were talking about.
Oh, the Ignite's down. Pawn actually gets in over the top here as Stand United did come down from Koro. Pawn just waits for the Ignite and is going to be able to get the second kill of the game.
And that's exactly how that works and why Kassadin is being picked into Victor in the LPL. You just get on top of him, you're able to outmaneuver the gravitational field, and his cooldowns are just so punishing against Victor. Able to get multiple rotations, multiple damage threats out before a laser or another gravitational field can come out to save him.
Yeah, especially before Victor had any opportunity to pick up any of that cooldown reduction. Of course, does like to grab the Merlin Omicron and the Lucidity boost. But Depp, there's the aggressive Valkyrie, already down to about half health. But TNT's going to go down to Clearlove as he grabs his second
here
kill. TCT
Pawn.
On the run.
Nope.
Pawn just going to back away as he was heading down here. Did have a cute little book in his back pocket. That's not going to build towards a Rod of Ages, but does have the Catalyst there as well. Goes back and grabs the boots.
Guys, come on. I want an assist. This is classic Pawn, though. He does this on a lot of his champions, because typically Kassadin, we've seen a couple of variations of builds where Kassadin won't buy boots for a long time just because he can rely on his Riftwalk, but it just speaks to Pawn as a player and his mentality. He'll get the boots on one of the highest mobile champions in the game because he wants to roam around. He wants to impact his map.
Yeah. And you can't reliably Riftwalk everywhere because you can see already it's Manabar, not exactly at the highest position. Does now have the blue buff to help that one out. But Kassadin runs out of it if he's going to be using that Riftwalk a lot. So unless you're in a fight, having those boots probably going to get you lane to lane.
Oh, wow. Look at the respect build from Doinbee. He backs and he immediately buys. He had a null magic.
Yeah, no magic mantle.
And now he upgrades it to the Negatron Cloak as opposed to focusing into his Hex Core. So definitely sacrificing a lot of his scaling wave clear and the evolution points on upgrading the Hex Core for just the sheer safety against Pawn's Kassadin.
I find it interesting as well just because once you upgrade the Q, of course, the second upgrade that you generally go for here, you can, you know, get a little bit extra movement speed, you can get away from this Kassadin a little bit more reliably, but not deciding to go for that once to spend the extra 350 gold after that null magic to grab the Negatron Cloak, make sure I can get that to that Abyssal Scepter as quickly as possible to nullify this damage from Kassadin.
Talked at length about the Abyssal Scepter and why I really like it in the current meta, just because so many teams are stacking magic damage. The fact that Corki is one of the primary AD carries being picked out, he is going to do magic damage. You've got Maokai, which again, you look at Maokai, you don't necessarily translate that into magic damage or a carry like Rumble, but he is still doing magic damage. Gragas, Braum, things like that. So the Abyssal Scepter empowers so many people across majority of these compositions.
Yeah, and it's sort of positive for sort of offense as well as for defense, as well as you're going to be getting a lot of defense against all of the magic damage that is running rampant at the moment in the current meta. So I like it a lot. Swift standing on a ward here with TCT. They might want to sweep that one out, because everyone knows that they're there. Scuttlecrab going to be re-engaged by Clearlove, who's 2-0. 66% of his team skills already this game, and does have the Runeglaive already completed.
Obviously going to empower Evelynn's clear speed just that much more. And he's really starting to take off, does have the CS advantage over Swift, 43-39. Not massive, but you tack on two of those kills.
Oh yeah.
The fact that he's out farming and out ganking.
Well, Stand United's here in the mid lane as Clearlove's going to get stunned by the gravity field. Nice explosive cast as Koro makes his way in, but Doinbee very, very low. Pawn! Oh, he's not going to get the kill. Koro's going to grab it. Tower's going to take down the Kassadin as Clearlove's going to get body slammed as well. Wants to be able to get out if he can. Barrel's there, not enough damage to finish it off, and Koro's pretty tanky. So it's going to be a one for one in the end.
Mako roams up, but it's pretty much just to clear things, reset the fight as he's quickly followed by TNT and TCT.
Yeah, Deft actually on his own now in the bottom side of the map, but Koro's going to be here. He's going to be able to defend this mid lane outer turret. Deft's going to grab himself a whole lot more kills here of the minions here in the bottom lane.
This is so punishing too, especially as Deft shoves that wave in. Look at the CS discrepancy between TNT and Deft. Although, maybe it's some trouble.
Yeah, still has the Valkyrie, going to use it to get away from the Winter's Bite.
So, is able to dodge the boomerang as well as the... Oh, he can dodge the Q, but not get locked up by the concussive blows. But again, just more important, 85-125.
That's the big deal.
Even the fact that he doesn't have a kill and only a single assist, you have to think about 13 to 15 CS is going to equate to a kill worth of gold. So Deft is well and far ahead. There you go. Over close to 1,000 gold.
Yeah, approximately 900 gold there in the lead is Deft. He's going to go back and possibly finish that Trinity Force as well. We'll see whether he does have enough gold for it. going to be getting well behind this turret, waiting for TNT to shove up this wave, grab a last one, and then possibly grab that Trinity Force.
This is the other thing that's getting very popular with the Uprise of Shen, is the Kassadin Shen composition. And anytime, and we've seen it now back-to-back, anytime the Stand United is off of cooldown, you'll notice that it's being burned on Kassadin, who just decides to go full crazy tower dive.
Yeah. And you may as well, of course. You've got that extra defensive
shield. Yep.
From Crow, who's just enabling Korra to do what he wants. B still farming quite nicely here on the top side of the map, but Korra has got the better of him at the moment. B with the Righteous Glory, slightly nerfed on this patch, but
gutted.
Still going to be doing some things to help out the team. Moving the tree faster is a good idea.
Do you expect that Braum will probably pick up another speed augment item? Likewise, you also have the Sivir ultimate to assist there with Righteous Glory.
I think going quick is going to be something that QG will be able to do.
They need to go quick right now because they may be caught out.
Well, Clearlove with the red buff now. They've got a lot of deep vision here to EDG around the red side of QG's jungle. Swift going to be paying a visit, but you can see everything just lit up like a Christmas tree on the bottom side of the map. Does mean that the top lane outer turret is going to fall. Korra did have to go back, so not going to be able to find that. Definite Mako just going to take down the bottom outer turret.
Using the Janna shield, making sure that they can tank that and just force it down. So trade one for one, but you are correct. The fact that EDG are spending so much of their time and resources on the bottom lane does mean that V is able to whittle away on that tower, especially because Stan United was used globally on that.
Yeah, well, EDG now going to be able to take the Rift Scuttler and possibly this dragon as well. Of course, no one from QG hanging around the area, so first dragon looks to be going down to EDG. Stand United was there as well, as Korra is on his own on the top side of the map. EDG going to be easily able to take this one down.
This is actually a really late dragon, so average dragon time is around 11 minutes. We're now coming on to 15 minutes, and we talked about how EDG, if there's one thing that's really changed since the rebirth of this MSI roster, it's their objective and dragon control in particular. They had a very early dragon clear yesterday, so vastly different this time around, but secure it.
Yeah. That being said, Swift stole away the blue buff from his mid laner. Doinb not going to be able to grab that one. Swift is a little bit greedy. No one up himself. I believe it may have been a little bit of a mistake. Back is going to be completed by Doinb in the mid lane as Pawn finishes up all of these minions, and Mako going to help clear out some vision around that bit as well. So at the moment, EDG just with all of the vision control around this.
Also, we can take a moment to check in on the initial itemization. So Corki has the Trinity Force. That's the obvious power spike. More importantly, Pawn did complete his ROA around 14 minutes, 30 seconds.
Yeah,
which
good clip.
Exactly. Typically, that's a minute early. That'll be stacked up around 20, 25 minutes. Otherwise, you have big resistances. Both resistances completed for Korra. Chose to finish the Spirit Visage first, because again, he's facing across from a lot of magic damage, as well as a kind of a low damage AD carry and Sivir versus a hyper carry like Vayne. So right now, EDG are just in full control. Could look for a 5v5. That said, there's no real arena set for them like a dragon.
Yeah, now that Spirit Visage is completed by Korra as well, you saw there in the top lane, there's nothing that V's going to do as far as damage to this Shen. I mean, of course, he has no damage either. The Farming Cinder probably not going to be augmenting too much of that. So EDG and QG, and as far as the top side of the map is concerned, it's going to be butting heads, but not really killing.
EDG really need to pull the trigger and possibly either collapse on this mid lane or, more importantly, collapse on the top lane. They are in full control to look for a 5v5 because TNT hasn't completed the Infinity yet. You do have the Abyssal Scepter on Doinb, which again is going to empower and augment his team a lot because of their magic damage. But with the Righteous Glory being the only completed item on V, they don't have a front tank line. If a 5v5 broke out within the next, you know, 2 to 5 minutes, Xiaogu are in a ton of trouble.
Yeah. Of course, V only being able to build up that health bar as Korra actually lands the Shadow Dash here onto V, getting some actual damage on the tree on the top side of the map. That being said, he's going to be able to disengage effectively, and Swift is taking down his jungle as well. Clearlove hanging around the area, did manage to get some wards in there, but that's going to be swept out by Swift.
They should... So what you see right now is the AD carry and the mid laner are not in the same lane because they're trying to be efficient about their gold and their lanes, making sure that Deft and Pawn are never splitting farm, as Clearlove sneakily and cheekily steals that away from Swift.
Very cute.
I feel like what they should do is Pawn should press this way forward, although he's trying to find an assassination on TNT, rotate mid, and then free up Mako and Deft to rotate top, and EDG should collapse on that top tower.
Yeah, take it down. Easy gold on the map at the moment for EDG if they wanted. Twisted Advance from V. using that passive to get himself back up to health. Spending a lot of time here on the top side of the map, just watching the Battle of the Ages as the tree is being attacked by the weird ninja.
The Titan's
very
clash.
Good at being a ninja. Defo, you can see, clearing out the mid lane. Still more than happy just to hang around here and try and pressure that out of turret if he can, as Victor's just going to be laser beaming the lane over and over again.
Yeah, so EDG actually going to take it fairly slow. This has been a little bit indicative of, again, going back to the Invictus Gaming series, where they started to really focus on dragon control, just being very cautious, respectful.
Methodical, would be another word.
I like to say it, but I feel like it's not as efficient. I feel like there's a very clear play to be made on the top side of the map, because there's no reason to play to the bottom side, because there's no dragon, so they wouldn't trade any sort of objective. But for some reason, just really prioritizing the fact that they'd rather just take the free farm lanes as opposed to try to make things happen on the map, despite the fact that they have an item advantage. So to me, I would say that this is a little bit too cautious, too respectful of EDG, that they could, you know, open the game wide. That said, it is kind of a high-risk, high-reward play, because if Xiaogu were to get a foot back into the game, diving a Maokai would probably be a bad idea.
Yeah, very good. But it does seem at the moment that both sides are going to be content with just hanging back, waiting for a later stage, possibly fighting around the next dragon that's going to be up in a minute and a half. Half a minute until the Baron spawns on the map as well, as we get closer to 20 minutes into this game.
So what this choice from EDG has created is it's opened up that CS discrepancy even further between Deft and TNT. The fact that Doinbi and TNT were sharing a lot of lane farm while they were, you know, trying to safely find places to farm, this has opened up from 20 CS to 50.
It's just ridiculous at the moment. It has meant that Pawn down on the bottom side of the map able to keep himself ahead, as well as Doinbi with the really long lane. Does not want to go too far out, because Pawn just has too much kill pressure on him at the moment. Almost has that Zhonya's Hourglass completed as well. Nir Silhouette Bob is completed. Banshee's Veil just popped onto Quilla, but already has his second item built up as well. And a lot of focus on the magic resist, but that's a bit of a, I guess, selfish magic resist purchase. Not decided to go for any lockets just yet out of the jungle here for EDG.
He's in the carry position, 2-0-1 right now, is EG finally stepping up to attempt to siege this tower, really just kind of poke it down.
Getting a few auto attacks off there.
Did he laugh?
He did. He was giggling quite a lot there with Death. Tower very, very low. Clear Love able to get the smite. Nice eye for the smite there.
He's denied that 3 or 4 times, and that's so important, because again, look at EDG and their vision control over Swift's bottom jungle. A big thing that teams really need to start getting into the habit of doing, especially when they are ahead, is making sure that they deny the Raptor camp. A lot of time teams will be ahead, they'll go and contest the red buff, the blue buff, you know, try to force fights a dragon. But it's so important to maintain your vision control to deny the Razor perk.
Yeah, and the fact that you can just spot out any ward that sees you as well means that even the sneaky wards you may not expect are going to be discovered. And when they're so close to that Raptor camp, it's important for EDG to keep control. But they're going to easily take down the second dragon here, as Pawn's able to take that one out with a Force Pulse. He's ahead by about 7 CS in comparison to that bottom lane, which is only getting worse here for QG. The mid lane outer turret is going to fall, so Def finally going to get that work done. Doinbi going to have a longer lane to work with now that he's made it back to the mid.
So Xiaogu trying to kind of stop the bleeding, although it's starting to get a little bit out of hand between the two AD carries. They are in a bit of a better position to look for the next fight at Dragon, simply because V now has his resistances, or at least some of his resistances up and running, has the Spectre's Cowl, as well as the Merc Treads to go along with his Righteous Glory. So we are starting to come to the stage of the game where Xiaogu can possibly think about a 5v5, and that's where they excel.
Yeah, there's also the fact that they have the Locket completed on Swift as well, so he's managed to grab the AoE magic resistance against this largely magic damage focused EDG team comp.
Entirely magic damage focused, including on Corki.
Yeah, well, of course, I was giving the hybrid damage to Corki there, so he does auto-attack a little bit. We did see that. But you're exactly right. The fact that magic resist is going to be king here for the QG lineup. This Mako's just battling these minions.
Trying to keep it out of the tower, so not only will Deft pick up all this free CS, pulls it into the tower, but he'll also get a decent 9 more freeze.
Yeah,
it's gonna. Actually, it's still pretty good.
Not too bad. TNT, though, trying to hold this wave at the turret, keep himself in a position to be able to grab some farm. It's been difficult for TNT at the moment. Always has been sort of a low economic AD carry, still able to get things done, but still needs some money, and that static ship is not going to pay for itself.
On, thinking about going full pawn.
Yeah, he's going in. Nice use of the spell shield means that no damage comes out. TCT makes his presence known, and Pawn's going to have to risk walk himself to safety, but not under any pressure at the moment.
That said, it is that time that with the mid-tier tower down as well as the bottom-tier tower, the most accessible and last-standing outer is going to be that top side, which means it's the easiest objective for you to look at.
Yeah, Karo actually getting twistedly advanced on by V, but once again, ignore this.
Something that's a little bit curious for EDD this game is that it is much more about kind of controlling the minion waves and stacking your gold lead off of farm versus skirmishes, which is what we saw, you know, typically if you're going to think about EDG, it's, you know, they love to 3v3, Pawn and Clear Love and Mako going crazy, snowballing that way versus, you know, trying to bleed people out by freezing waves and controlling side lanes and things like that, which is what we've seen here,
yeah.
Especially between TNT and Death. And it's cool too, because if you think all the way back to World Elite History Time with Roskrin, their coach Aaron, when talking to Wei Xiao, he was one of the earliest players that people credited the idea of slow pushing to. If you think about his Ezreal play, he would use Ezreal to clip waves around the map. As I say this though, Swift getting to safety. But he credited that to Aaron, that Aaron was one of the first coaches, at least for WE on record, to consider slow pushing and playing with waves and teaching that to his team. So it's nice to see EDG, I mean, this isn't like a slow push, but playing more with minion waves and controlling gold that way versus trying to snowball it in skirmishes.
Yeah, making sure they keep the minion waves in the right position so that QG can't find their way back into the game with that. That being said, TNT was able to pick up a couple of waves, but now he's behind 70 CS as Deft has just been eating up wave after wave here in the mid. And you're right, I mean, EDG have been making it look easy as far as slowing everything down, picking up all of the farm that they can, and they've been just slowly getting themselves a bigger and bigger lead. Now at about 3,500 gold, after there was a lot of aggression early on, and then absolutely nothing for the last 6 or 7 minutes.
And this goes back to the question, yes, EDG looks strong, but do they look different? And I say yes, they do look different. They are doing different things. This is not normally how EDG win games. This is very similar to Xiao Gu. We talked about this composition. They've run this multiple times, and this is still a very EDG-esque comp in that it's a lot of comfort champions. But again, all about the dragon control, all about controlling your waves, denying the enemy as much CS as possible, building up your gold lead. That way, I do feel that this is EDG, you know, experimenting. Or at least maturing in their various styles.
Yeah, and it looks like a lot of the things that they're doing are very deliberate as well. A lot of what EDG used to do was rely on the fact that their mechanics were just incredibly strong. They'd be able to win a lot of these skirmishes just off the back of being better players, but it has become a little bit of a different story with a lot of the new superstars heading into the LPL. It means that they have to play a more cerebral game of League of Legends, and they're showing us that they can do that.
Especially with Pawn here. I mean, if we think about classic EDG, it's Pawn just doing crazy things and distracting as many people as possible, maybe killing two of them while he's at it, and EDG just kind of taking something else on the map underneath him. The Darien effect.
The Darien effect. It's a beautiful effect. One of my personal favorites. As Karo is going to make his way towards the river, dashing his way over the top. Not going to be able to spot that ward as V, he's up the top side as well. TNT, TCT hanging around with Deft and Mako in the mid lane.
Deft has over perfect CS.
He does.
Yep.
So over by a very long way.
You,
as well.
Yeah, it's good to average around 10 CS a minute. So at 27 minutes, you would consider, you know, 270 to be incredible. Like, wow, that's awesome. He's got just shy 300 CS at 27 minutes.
Yeah. So Deft is most definitely being able to pick up as much farm as he would like this game. Now has a Bloodthirster in his back pocket as well, the Sorcerer's Shoes and the Trinity Force. Longsword cheekily hanging out there as well. We'll see what he decides to pick up to augment the rest of his items. But I love this build from Corki. So much poke focus with the flat AD from that Bloodthirster. The fact that you're a little bit more safe as well, and the fact that you get double shield with that Eye of the Storm on top of everything just means that extra AD and extra survivability for the Corki.
And what it's also really going to empower is not necessarily the Shred and the Kite in the team fights, although he doesn't need the Blade of the Ruined King just because he's so far ahead of V. V just now completing his Spirit Visage, which, yes, he's facing against a lot of magic damage, but Corki is so much flat AD right now. It's going to empower Sieging Towers. Obviously, the difference between an Infinity Edge and a Bloodthirster is you can't crit a tower. It's going to be more cost-effective to Sieging to build the BT, likewise with the Janna Shield. So, should expect to see EDG start grouping up and Sieging as they controlled their third dragon, so far uncontested.
And it's why we see a lot of the sort of Boots 2 build out of the AD carries that want to be Sieging Towers with the ingredients for that Infinity
Edge.
The BF
and the pickaxe.
As opposed to completed as Swift, is actually going to find himself in a very uncomfortable position. Nice explosive cast to try and disengage this, but it's not going to be enough. Pawn's going to grab it with the W-empowered auto attack. And EDG, we'll see whether they go for a Baron. There are pings around it, but I believe that's from QG, and EDG not going to go for an early one. 28 minutes. I can imagine that EDG of old would have just said, okay, Baron time, boys.
They've so far managed to amass about a 4K gold lead for themselves and, you know, really just kind of farming waves. Most of that is going to be the difference between two AD carries, Death versus TNT again, pointing down to that CS. I wanted to see him eclipse TNT by 100 CS. He's really starting to edge close.
He's getting there, of course, only about 20 behind that one. We're talking about Death being 20 behind because he's AD CS in the lead. Death does have massive amounts of shield, so that stun in front of the tower, not going to do anything at all. Outer does fall on the top side of the map, so all of the outer is now completely gone from QG, and the map opened here for EDG.
And as this map opens up, yes, it is empowering to TNT, or excuse me, Xiaogu, because they do have TNT on that Sivir, and obviously the Sivir ultimate gets more powerful the farther you have to run, but it becomes very scary likewise because you're dealing with the paranoia and the stealth of Evelynn, as well as the chase potential and stick potential of Kassadin.
TNT is going to be able to grab his red buff, though. All of the wards from EDG on this bottom side of the map, QG's jungle, have dissipated for the majority. Still a couple hanging around that dragon pit, but not as many as there were before. Doinby's doing a good job clearing out these minion waves now that he has a whole lot more AP. Voidstaff completed, as well as that Abyssal Scepter, and some cooldown reduction with those Lucidity Boots as well. But you can see Kuro and V, they've been basically non-factors as far as this game is being concerned, but they're farming up about even at the moment, just getting to their late game tankiness as quickly as they can.
And touching on Doinby's build that you just brought up, you know, having to go the Void Staff.
Yeah, third item.
Yeah, just to keep his damage consistent. I mean, this is trying to be as cost efficient as possible to still be a factor into this mid game. Typically, you wouldn't want to go Void this early, but again, because EDG has just amassed a lead from farming better, their resistances are up and online before, you know, the death cap or anything like that, that Victor would be able to pull out.
Unable to find it there as Death, with 345 CS, does go back and pick himself up his third item in the Last Whisper. So this Corki is most definitely at a power point. That is
a
lot of damage.
Massive. That's, you know, a 40-minute Corki running around 10 minutes early.
Yeah, and at the moment, QG have just let EDG do whatever they want. It's basically been this whole game.
Which is the thing, the gold difference isn't that massive. I mean, 4K is still pretty sizable, but for kind of the, I guess, the limited action that you've seen visually around the map in terms of kills, it's only 1 to 5. EDG are in full control of this game. They dictated every aspect of it. So it's a little bit misleading to say, like, oh, you know, EDG are only slightly ahead, this could be 1 teamfight, which, true, I mean, Xiaogu could pull this back. They're one of the best team fighting teams in the league that said, you know, you're facing against EDG. But just, again, EDG, they normally don't win like this, and it's a very controlled, respectful style.
Yeah, we do have a perfect hex score now completed for Doinby. Static Shiv has been done for TNT as well as those Berserker's Grief. So TNT now with his sort of core itemization, a lot of extra wave with burst damage with that Static Shiv as well. His blue buff is going to get stolen away. Death going to secure that one, but Agony's Embrace here on the bottom side. Nice placement of the gravity field of Swift, getting taken down very, very low. Teleport in from V as he's able to get on top of Pawn. Nice on his Hourglass to mitigate some
of the damage.
And TNT, huge burst as the Monsoon comes out to get the front line out of this battle. Pawn does have to get the heck out of this fight now. Very, very low, and Swift, the only casualty of that face-off.
That could have been so much worse. Oh, hold on.
Clearlove going for the assassination play under Doinby. Not going to find it there. The rest of EDG making their way around as well. TNT in the back line. Nice rockets from Deft, going to be poking out QG here. And it was just Klilov thinking that, yep, I can get something done here, boys. Don't worry about it.
I thought for sure that that was going to spell disaster for Shadow. Oh, and I was going to say, and they won't turn on the Baron. I said in the middle of that fight, that's going to be the Baron. EDG are immediately going to turn on it. They decide that this is the lead that they wanted. Super risky, though. Swift isn't there for the smite. They don't have a secondary smite in their top laner because it's Maokai. Free Baron.
Yep, they're going to grab it. Riftwalk and Valkyrie used to get over the wall here by the EDG carries. That's a very easy Baron here as Mako just going to back on a ward, but the Empowered Recall going to help him get back there. And QG, they only lost one member from that last team fight, and EDG knew that because it was the jungler, they'll easily be able to take that Baron. And because it's just been a very, very, I guess, I don't know, passive QG. They haven't been making aggressive moves. Nothing has been done on QG's terms this game.
Xiaogu are actually very smart about understanding when they're behind and understanding kind of the win conditions that they have going forward. So yes, I agree. They have been passive. The issue is they haven't been able to be proactive, which has set the pace for EDG. But they understand when they're weak and they understand when they can't fight. And they did a good job hiding from EDG. So we kind of think, you know, EDG forced them into that engagement right there, understanding that, okay, we're strong enough now that we can just mow them over, grab the Baron, and start speeding this game up. Because again, as I was saying earlier, the gold difference wasn't that sizable, but EDG are in full control. But the brilliance about Xiaogu is they understood this and they were just trying to minimize loss. Unfortunately, they just don't have the answers. Again, we talk about Xiaogu, they're fantastic in the 5v5, but EDG are playing a macro-oriented, effectively a wave control game against them, you know, amassing all of this farm lead on Deft. This hits Xiaogu exactly where they're weak. We talked about it in the pregame, you know, where you're going to beat them, it's around the map, and that's exactly what EDG did.
Well, Pawn going for a very aggressive play to Doinby here, blows the Zhonya's Hourglass. Doinby has to run away from his tower. Four members of EDG head down here. Pawn easily able to lock that kill down with a force pulse, and this inner turret most definitely dead, and I don't think Doinby was expecting four people to come from behind his turret.
And now EDG are just going to walk this one through. I mean, I hate to call it this early, but this was really cleanly played, just from start to finish.
Yeah, it was just a strategic victory, and the fact that EDG knew that there was nothing that Xiaogu could do. They were able to take every objective on the map, and the fact that they weren't making strategic mistakes meant that there was no way back in.
Mm-hmm. And this is something that the LPL is actually really strong in the meta right now. A lot of people, you know, they look at the LPL, okay, what is it good at? It's good at 5v5, team fighting, typical Chinese aggression. The thing that's more accurate to say is that the LPL is really good at trading objectives.
Yeah.
And almost to the extent, especially of the lower bracket teams, you know, King, Ward, Elite, they'll almost kind of sacrifice all of their map, unfortunately, because they just understand, you know, we can't fight now. It's, yeah, 5v5 is still a very key part of the Chinese meta, but understanding exactly when you can and cannot fight is something very core to the LPL, which is why you see Xiaogu, you know, we can't fight now, we have to be scared.
Yeah, but when can they fight is the real question.
On a pick.
Explosive cask.
Which is what Swift is looking for there.
Yeah.
So anytime that they approach a dragon, which they're going to have to approach the next one because it's four dragons, they can't let EDG have that fifth dragon window. And EDG have backed Xiaogu, excuse me, LGD backed Xiaogu into this exact same trap when they first faced. It's Swift looking for a pick on the cask.
Well, there is the Agony's Embrace one more time. Doinby gets exploded as the Shadow Dash comes through. V tries to get on top of Pawn, but another fantastic Zhonya's in there to save his life. Riftwalk over the wall here as well as EDG are playing around in QG's base. Rockets over from Deft as Koro's just untouchable in this base. Waiting for a Shadow Dash is going to get over the wall, and QG, they lose their mid laner, and there's nothing that they can do to respond.
I'm actually really excited about this. If you think back to, you know, 15 minutes when I was saying, why aren't EDG playing to the top side? They could just dive that tower. They could ramp up this game. That's what we would expect from EDG, and now it all clicks into place. Why do that? Because that would be fighting on Xiaogu's terms, when you can just bleed them out through macro play.
Precisely what they've been doing. Deft's still 4 TCS ahead of the clock, as well as he's sitting on about 410, almost has the Infinity Edge done to augment all the rest of his super high damage items. This is a ridiculously fed Corki as he's sitting on 202 at the same time. And I say ridiculously fed, and I mean it, even though his scoreline doesn't necessarily say, oh, he's got like 18 kills, why is he so fed? It's the fact that he's been able to sit around, grab all the farm that he wants, and in a low kills game, only 9 by 37 minutes, he's easily the strongest man on the map.
I love it. Look at where the LPL has come. Normally, you would look at a Chinese game, it would be 25 to 23 kills. We are now 1 to 8 with over a 10k gold deficit between the two teams.
Yeah. and it's all purely strategic play. And I can see the pride in your eyes, Frostgrim.
I promised myself I wouldn't cry.
It's clear love, I think you're allowed to hear it. Oh my god, body slammed. There's the stun. Uses the Zhonya's. Is he going to be out of Zhonya's over? Flashes into it. Gets over the wall. Oh my goodness, the flash. Koro's in here. Goes straight over the wall as Clear Love's making his way around. That's a four-man Agony's Embrace as well as V teleports in. Decent use of the Glacial Fissure there as Koro's only down to about half health. Gravity Field doing some work. Death! He's going to finally get taken down. Toynbee once again is going to fall as Mako gets stunned up and destroyed. QG get a 2-for-1.
Classic Pawn. We were just talking about, you know, they've matured so much. It's all about... Nope, I got to face check this bush, guys. Xiaogu, pull a Fnatic.
Yep. Well, Koro going to get a Shadow Dash over the top. Pawn is going to find TNT there as well. As Pawn down to about half health. Doesn't have the Zhonya's available anymore as he gets over with a Riftwalk. Nice use of the slow there as TCT looking for the kill into Pawn. Swift completely out of mana as he gets on top of him. Is he going to be able to find the kill though? No mana for Pawn. No mana for Swift. Clear Love's coming around as well. Does have the red buff. Body slam! And he's going to be able to lock it down with a W here as hate spikes from Clear Love. Gonna follow Swift around, but he doesn't think he can grab it. Koro is taking so long to die on the bottom side of the map as V is gonna eventually, I have a feeling, be able to clean up that kill, but TCT did have to go down for it. In the end, I'm not sure how many kills that was in favor of either team.
That's still primarily in favor of Xiaogu. They needed something to have on the map. So what they did is they set a trap. They know that this has all been about the CS. So they stand in a bush, understanding that someone from EDG is going to come and clear this massive wave. It was Pawn. And instead of taking the safe route down the lane into the farm.
Why would he do that?
Because it's Pawn. Remember what I was saying about how Pawn really needs to play champions with repositions? Because sometimes he just puts himself in the worst places.
Yep.
Yeah, that was one of those Pawn moments.
Example one.
Example A.
Yeah, exhibit A, right there. But, of course, Pawn, having a casual meander down the river, you can't really hold that against him. Just wanted to do so.
Okay, this is the big thing. We have massive level discrepancies between both of these two teams. Look for the cask. Swift has to find a pick here. They need a 4v5 advantage.
Yeah, Koro up in about 3 seconds with the Stand United. This dragon down to about half health. 1,000 to go. Oh, it is going to be locked down by Swift there. So no fifth dragon, but Swift, he's going to die first. Clear Love takes down that kill right in amongst the fight here as TNT has to flash over. Nice knock up there onto three people as the gravity field's down. Koro trying to tank up all of the damage, but EDG, they haven't lost a member just yet, and Swift was a large portion of the front line. V is going to die, and that is all the front line dead and death. Valkyrie's over the top. Going to be taken out by TNT. He's going to fall as well eventually here as he's trying to kite around. Pawn able to rift walk on top of him, and Koro not going to get stunned up. It's a double kill for the mid laner of EDG. And V did survive somehow. Mako, are you going to find him? No, I'm just going to wander into the brush.
But look at this. Again, you can't slight Xiaogu and their performance. They are 11k gold down. Managed to deny the fifth dragon bonus from EDG, but more importantly, they almost won that team fight.
Yeah.
There were so many low health members, and of course Deft made a fatal error, Valkyrie forward. You could see the instantaneous regret as he just mashes himself into a Braum Q and then immediately gets concussive blows into death.
Yeah, there was a gravity field there as well on top of him that was a bit of a struggle to deal with.
But this is why EDG wanted to play the macro game. Not only have they been experimenting with it for the last kind of three sets, but it is so terrifying to fight Xiaogu in a straight 5v5. 11k gold. If that was even, they would have won.
Yeah, and there's also the fact that Swift went down incredibly quickly in that fight. If he was able to be there, be the disruption for the team as effectively as he generally is, then that could have been a whole lot worse there for EDG. But in the end, it is going to be a 4-for-1 as QG now trying to wrestle control of the vision around this Baron. The top lane going to be dealt with by Deft here as Clear Love just waiting in the wings.
Something
to get around.
Very scary is you have to think that your gold lead only means something to a point. It's a race to six items. And as you approach, you know, 60k, 65, 70k, it really doesn't matter if you have a 200 CS lead on someone. You wasted your window of opportunity where you had that lead.
Yeah, you need to make sure that the item discrepancy is utilized when it actually exists. Koro, though, with a gigantic minion wave here on the bottom side of the map. TNT is going to have a fantastic time clearing that one out.
You know what teams that I would never want to face at, you know, 55 minutes when it's a single team fight game?
Yep.
EDG and Xiaogu.
Pretty much. I wouldn't like to face Snake even because they do ridiculous things.
Oh yeah.
A lot of the team fighting actually in the LPL has been fantastic as V finds his way in here. Nice Monsoon from Mako
to try
and get him out, but Clearlove's going to lock down the Baron. Mako already down to half health as Depth trying to Valkyrie his way away from V. Swift gets on top of him though. Does he have the flash? No, not just yet. He's going to go down. QG with a huge team fight as Koro's trying to tank up, but he's in just a little bit too late. Clearlove, happy birthday. You're dead as Koro able to manage to get out of this one. Shadow Death going to get him a little bit further away, but there's the stun. Swift and TCT with no damage at all eventually get that kill secured, and that's 4-0 in favor of QG.
The Monsoon was used to make sure that EDG got the Baron by pushing Swift away, but as soon as it was used, that gave Xiaogu the go-ahead. They can't reset the fight. They're trapped in the Baron pit. They've taken damage from the objective, and now is our time to strike. Even better, the Chaos Storm only hit one member, and they destroyed that fight.
Well, Fawn over the top here. They are going to lose their inhibitor turret, I believe, as Fawn's trying to get some work done. Does use the Zhonya's. QG piled on top of him, though. Rift walks himself out. Does have the spell shield. Has to flash. Is the Rift walk going to be available? I'm not sure whether it is. There's the barrel. Swift locks down the ace. And EDG lose everyone. What is going on?
EDG sacrificed the Monsoon for the Baron, but get aced and lose the inhibitor. And we talked about this. You know, this gold lead doesn't mean anything.
No. Not anymore. Is QG just able to navigate these team fights in the late game? The fact that TNT is not being itemized against, there's a couple of Randuin's there. There's now a Thornmail completed by Clearlove as he went back to base. But the fact is, this Sivir is doing so much AoE AD damage. EDG do not have as an easier time dealing with the mixed damage that's coming out of this QG lineup, and it's just biting them.
And that's why it's so important that the Monsoon be used correctly to reset the fight, to make sure that it's in between Victor's cooldowns, and he can't just sit there, stack his Venn diagram of murder on top of the ricochet from Sivir.
Well, at the moment, QG coming off fantastic team fighting ability. They did lose the Baron, so of course they weren't able to utilize that. Not going to be able to get into another lane and make things work. And as the dust settles, we'll see whether EDG can find a team fight that suits them moving forward. Only one item slot to go here for Doimby. Does have an instantly large rod. We'll see whether that is going to be the Rabbit and Deathcap, or whether he feels like he might need that Zhonya's Hourglass as well, which this I could imagine he would.
This is why a lot of us will consider Xiaogu in contention for the world seeding and placement for to represent China. You think back to their game against LGD, where, again, they pretty much got manhandled. LGD would quickly found the 2-0 against Xiaogu. But Xiaogu were so good at playing from behind and identifying the perfect win condition for their scenario. And it's just something that it's unfortunate. It doesn't reflect. If you're just looking at, you know, past games, okay, Xiaogu got 2-0'd by this team, you know, they split with this team, things like that. But they are so good at playing from behind. This is why I consider them, you know, the elite, one of the top-level Chinese teams. Because EDG has been running them around this entire game. But to find this at 46 minutes, to have a 50-50 chance at winning this game, is awesome.
Yeah, that's the fact as well, that they have positional advantage around this dragon as well. EDG making their way in, but the dragon has spawned and it's going to go down incredibly quickly. You can see QG easily able to lock it down and nothing EDG could do about it.
Starting to ramp back up, empowering their turrets. Again, EDG having to always respond to that mid lane pressure because they have lost the inhibitor.
Yeah. EDG, just, I would have expected them to set up for that dragon a little bit more. You mentioned the fact that EDG have been focusing a little bit more on making sure they have more control over the dragon area, and just hasn't happened towards the later stages of this game.
This is when Xiaogu's composition as a true 5v5 really starts to shine versus the pick potential that EDG's comp has. They need to make a pick and then look for a numbers discrepancy since the gold lead doesn't matter anymore, whereas in a straight 5v5, who's going to win? Victor Shen or Victor Maokai?
Well, Clearlove was looking for the flank here, but he is going to get picked out. There's the Stand United. Gravity Field down as well, but Clearlove, he's not the focus anymore. Pawn makes his way into the backline. Nice flash taunt there coming out, but the explosive cast splits up the whole fight. Oh my goodness, Death going off in this team fight. Dustfly getting so much damage down Pawn. He didn't fall either, and EDG answering QG's ability to team fight with their own prowess. as Def just kiting everyone around. V's going to be the last to die, and the clean ace for EDG is Koro. He wants to finish the game.
But it's how that team fight set up. So again, Xiaogu, they think that they have a pick on Clearlove. What happens is instead of a full 5v5 where everyone's clumped up together initially, it starts out as a 2v3, and a lot of cooldowns are initially burned on Clearlove. Deft, again, a massive leap of faith, Valkyries forward to make sure that he gets over the wall, and V is just slightly late to make sure that the cat or the Maokai ult is protecting his team before Pawn's burst damage goes off.
And speaking of burst damage, it was the fact that EDG were just able to get theirs all laid across, and Doimby and TNT just could not withstand it at all. No Zonya's available for this victor, and it is going to be the surrender of OQG, taken down by EDG in game one of this series. But man, that battle back after a 10k gold deficit was so incredibly good by QG, and I can't wait for the next game.
Two of the best team fighting teams, not only in the world, but certainly in the LPL. That almost a coin toss. Xiaogu, congratulations to EDG, but they played great that set.
They certainly did, and Clearlove, happy birthday, managed to pick himself up
the first birthday
blood
buff
as well. Yeah, and playing on his favorite champion in Evelynn at the same time. We'll see what they do to mix it up in the next game, as we are going to switch sides as QG are going to move on to the other one. We'll see whether that is going to change things as far as how this is going to work out. But, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to take a